Welcome to the viewers for this lecture on matrix methods of structural analysis. So before my lecture, let me introduce myself. Myself is Dr.P.Perumal, retired professor from Government Engineering College of Tamil Nadu. This is my address, this is my phone number, and this is my email ID. Now today we'll take up the introduction part. The lecture one will be on introduction to matrix methods of structural analysis. We have written books on this subject. Before that, for the overall subject, the books referred are the structural analysis books by Dr. B. C. Punmiya, Jain and Jain, Gupta, Pandit and Gupta, Prakash Rao, Ramamrudam, C. S. Reddy, Manika Selvam. Particularly for matrix analysis of structures, Rubinstein approach is widely followed. Rubinstein, Negin, Jangit, Prasad Elatwani. These are the plus support books of other authors. Also, we have written, myself and my senior author and my guide, Dr. Vaidyanathan sir, we have published books on structural analysis. Structural analysis, volume 1 and 2. And structural analysis through short questions and answers by my guide and senior author, Dr. Vaidyanathan sir, and myself. We have published books. Of course, this book, we have started the publication in the year 2003, and this is published by Lakshmi Publications, New Delhi. That is about the So, you know, structural analysis is a very important subject for civil engineers. You know, any structure, maybe a building, maybe a bridge or any structure will receive loads at some points and transmit it safely to other points. So that is there. So in this process, the structure or the elements of the structure will be subjected to various internal forces and also displacements. So forces and displacements are two important quantities. But so here we have number of methods for analysis, so many methods for structural analysis, namely moment distribution method, slope deflection method, strain energy method, and like that. We have got so many methods. They will be suitable for only structures with less degree of interdependency. For large scale structures, the matrix analysis will be very comfortable. Particularly after the advent of computers, the matrix methods have become very popular. Now in matrix methods, we have got two approaches. We have got two methods. One is the matrix flexibility method. Flexibility method. The other one is matrix stiffness method. Matrix stiffness method. So these are the. So here, as I told, the force and displacements are important quantities. So in the matrix flexibility method, forces are treated as unknowns. In the matrix stiffness method, displacements are treated as unknowns. So we know when the force displacement behavior of a structure is known, then the behavior of the structural system is known. So that is, in an elastic structure, the measurement of these two are important. So we call them as generalized forces. We call the forces are called the generalized forces, or it is called generalized displacements. That is, they can be independently applied. They can be independently applied without, suppose if we apply three forces F1, F2, F3, if F1, F2, F3 can be applied independently without affecting the other, that is called a generalized force or independent forces. Similarly, generalized displacement, generalized force, generalized displacements. So the forces that are measured will be represented in the form of a vector, say F1, F2, up to Fn. So this is called a generalized. So the values of F1 and F2, it can be a transverse force, this can be a moment, this can be an axial force, the other can be a torque. So that is why it is called generalized forces. So they may not be always, they may not be transverse force or axial force. One can be a force, the other can be a moment, the other can be torque. Similarly, displacements U1, U2, U3 up to UN. So one may be transverse displacement, U2 may be an axial displacement, this may be a rotation, this may be a twist, it can be anything. We give some numbering. Suppose if we take a structure like this, we call this as 1, we call this as 2, we call this as 3, we call this as 4. 1 stands for vertical force, as far as force is concerned. It is a vertical displacement as far as a displacement. So in this order, this force, the force is F1, the displacement is U1, which is a transverse displacement. So suppose you take 3, 3 is a moment, 3 is a moment. So coming to force, it is F3. Coming to displacement, it is U3. So accordingly, it will be numbered and arranged. So that is called generalized forces and generalized displacements. As I told, the matrix flexibility method is always called as the force method. It's always called as the matrix flexibility method is called as the force method, because we treat forces as unknowns, or it is called compatibility method. The stiffness method is always called the displacement method. Or it is called the equilibrium method. So the stiffness method is always, because the displacements are treated as the primary unknowns. So these are the primary unknowns. So, for this method, the equation, compatibility equation for this will be, A into F equal to U. A into F equal to U. That is the compatibility equation that is used for the matrix flexibility method. A is the flexibility matrix. This is the force vector. This is the displacement vector. So here, these are the unknown, these are the primary forces are the primary unknowns, that is why it is always called as a force method. So coming to this, the equilibrium equation will be K K into U equal to F. K is the stiffness matrix. K is the stiffness matrix. U, displacement vector, and F, the force vector. Force vector. Now here, this is the unknown. These are the unknowns. Unknowns. Primary unknowns. So in the first method, the forces will be, the unknown forces will be obtained using A inverse and U. In the second one, the displacements U will be K inverse into F. Now, this for statically determinate structures and that statically indeterminate structures, how to form the A matrix, how to form the K matrix, these things will be discussed later. Now, it is only the introduction part to matrix method, structural analysis. So, these are the unknowns, primary unknowns in matrix flexibility method. These are the primary unknowns in the matrix stiffness method. Let me introduce what is the A matrix and also what is the K matrix. Now, the matrix A will be consisting of flexibility coefficients. Will be A11, A12, up to A1n, A21. A22 up to A2n. This is the flexibility matrix consisting of flexibility coefficients. So, for getting the flexibility matrix for a statically determinate structure, it is easy because you can take, suppose you take a cantilever, you can say this is coordinate 1, this is coordinate 2, this is coordinate 3, this is coordinate 4. Like that, you can fix coordinates. Coordinates are locations in a structure and the direction in which a measurement is desired. That is, we may apply a force along 1, find out the displacement along 1, 2, 3, and 4. That will be the flexibility coefficients. Similarly, we can apply a force along coordinate 4, find out the displacements along 1, 2, 3, and 4. So, for forming the flexibility matrix, you choose coordinates. Coordinates are only arbitrary. We can add some more coordinates. We can add, say, 5, you can add 6, like that. Coordinates are only arbitrary locations and directions which gives where the measurement is desired. You may apply a force along that, find out the displacement, or apply a displacement, find out the force consistent with the displacement. So that is, suppose if there are 6 coordinates, the size of this flexibility matrix will be 6 by 6. If there are 4 coordinates, the size of the flexibility matrix will be 4 by 4. So, that is in the case of statically determinate structures. For statically indeterminate structures, so we have to convert the structure as a primary structure. Suppose if we want to analyze a continuous beam or a total frame, first we have to convert the structure as a statically determinate structure. Statically determinate structure is called as a primary structure. We have to remove, if the structure is indeterminate to 3 degrees, we have to remove any 3 reaction or force components. We have to remove them. make the structure statically integrate. So that primary structure, after removing the required number of redundants from the indeterminate structure, is called as the primary structure. Primary structure is a statically determinate structure. So we have to remove as many number of redundants as required and make the structure as a primary structure. Right. So that we will discuss later, because introduction part that will be too much. Now coming to the flexibility coefficient. The flexibility coefficient is Aij. Aij is the flexibility coefficient. Aij stands for the displacement at coordinate I, the displacement at coordinate I due to unit force at coordinate J. Unit force at coordinate J. Suppose we take a structure. We take a structure with only two coordinates. One is this coordinate, the other one is this coordinate. So we want to find out the to apply the force along one, find out the displacement, and also the rotation. Apply unit force along one only. Find out the force and the displacement. So that is called. This is A11. This rotation is A21. A21 stand means we apply unit force only along coordinate 1. Measure the displacement. That is A11. A11 is the displacement along coordinate 1 due to unit force at the coordinate 1. That is A11. Of course, here a knowledge of the basic that you have studied in strength of materials, namely methods of finding out deflection by moment area method or conjugate beam method, will be a prerequisite. So a knowledge of for dealing with the matrix methods, some fundamental topics are to be remembered. So one of that is methods of finding out the deflection, because we have studied deflection of beams as a full chapter and solved this as one full problem when you have studied synth materials. Now here it becomes fundamentals. So you must know how to find out the deflection by moment area method or conjugate beam method. So A21 is the displacement. So this gives the displacement. This is the coordinate 2. If it is a force, it is moment. If it is displacement, it is rotation. So flexibility coefficient gives you the displacement. Displacement along coordinate 2 due to unit force along 1 only. Suppose if there are only two coordinates, the size of the matrix will be 2 by 2 only. Now you can get A11 and A21. If the size of the number of coordinates is 2, the size of the flexibility matrix will be 2 by 2. Next, what you are doing is you have to apply unit force along coordinate 2 only. You apply unit force. Find out that is also going to give you displacement as well as the rotation. So this is the displacement along coordinate 1. This is the coordinate 1 direction. Displacement along coordinate 1 due to unit force along coordinate 2. This is the rotation. So this is the coordinate. Therefore the rotation, that is called displacement, generalized displacement. So a displacement along coordinate 2 due to unit force at the coordinate. So after finding out A12, A22 by using moment area method or conjugate beam method, we can find out the values. We can find out A12. So like this, for getting the flexibility matrix for statically determinate structures will be easy. For getting indeterminate structures, as I told earlier, we have to make the structure statically determinate and then do it. That we will discuss a little later. It's only introduction part. One more point before leaving this is, we are using what is called the principle of superposition of forces here. That is also one reason to call it as force method. Yeah. So in the case of elastic linear structures, what you can do is apply the force. Now you have got two forces. You have got force along coordinate 1, force along coordinate 2. For this is the rotation. So we apply force along coordinate 1, find out the displacement and rotation. Force along coordinate 2 only, find out the displacement and rotation. When I add this, this will be A21 plus A22. This will be A11 plus A12. This is what is called the principle of superposition of forces. That is, the effect of applying number of forces can be obtained by applying the forces individually. Apply 1 and 2. You apply 1 separately, find out the values, 2 separately, find out. So this is what is called, so this is equal to this plus this. This is what is called the principle of superposition of forces. So the reason for calling the method matrix flexibility method as force method is, one is the forces are treated as unknowns, and also we apply principle of superposition of forces. So this is applicable only for linear and elastic structures. So this is about the flexibility matrix for statically determinate structures. So we have discussed, so we know that the forces are treated as unknowns. For F equal to A inverse into U. A inverse into U. So after getting the flexibility matrix, how to get the unknown forces and how to combine the effect of other forces and get the final bending moment diagram and shear force diagram, we will discuss after discussing the step-by-step procedure for the flexibility matrix method. Now it's only introduction about this thing. Now coming to matrix stiffness method, as we have discussed, the displacement U, the displacement vector U equal to K inverse into F. K is the stiffness matrix. So K is the stiffness matrix. K11, K12, K1N. And one more point is, the flexibility matrix is a symmetric matrix. The flexibility matrix will be a square matrix. The size of the flexibility matrix depends upon the static indeterminacy of the structure. If the structure is statically indeterminate to n degrees, then the size of the matrix will be n by n. Suppose we take a portal frame of static indeterminacy 3, then the size of the flexibility matrix will be 3 by 3. The size of the flexibility matrix is decided by the static indeterminacy of the structure. And this flexibility matrix has some properties. It is a square matrix. All the values along the leading diagonal will be always positive. The values along the leading diagonal will always be positive. The values K11, K22, K23, like that, A11, A22, A up to ANM, the values will be positive. All the values. And half mode values will be positive or negative or zero. So that is about some of the properties of the flexibility matrix. So the size of the flexibility matrix depends upon the static indeterminacy of the structure. Of course, in the case of statically determinate structure, the size of the flexibility matrix is the number of coordinates that we consider. If you consider 4 coordinates, 4 into 4 will be the size of the matrix. So that is different. Right, coming to
the stiffness matrix K22 up to K2N up to KN1 KN2 up to KN. These are the stiffness coefficients. The stiffness coefficient will be called as Kij. Kij is the force caused at node I due to unit displacement at node J with the condition that no displacement occurs except at J. That is, the point is, suppose if you take only say two coordinates as before, we will take the same example 1 and 2. So here you are going to form the, now here again the size of the matrix will be 2 by 2 because we consider only two coordinates. Size of the coordinates will be 2 by 2. Okay. Now, okay, first we apply the displacement along coordinate 1 only. Displacement along coordinate 1 is the vertical displacement. When we, so here we can allow vertical displacement as well as rotation. The according to the definition for Kij, when vertical displacement is allowed, we should not allow rotation. That is, we treat the other end as fixed, and it will be horizontal. You know, effect of fixing is to make the end slope to be zero. So this will be horizontal. There will not be any slope here. We allow only vertical displacement. We are applying unit displacement along one only. Find out what is the force, what is the moment that is required, Of course, the direction of this may be anything. You can assume anti-clockwise or you can assume clockwise, because if the assumption is wrong, they are arbitrary, the assumption is wrong, you will be getting the final answer with the negative sign. It is not a problem. So this will be, this is the displacement. You assume unit displacement only along coordinate 1. So the force that is developed here, the force may be upward or force may be downward. Again, direction is not a problem. K, the force developed along coordinate 1 due to unit displacement along coordinate 1. This is the force developed along 2 due to unit force along coordinate 1, unit displacement only along coordinate 1. Therefore, this will give you the first column K11, K21. Okay. So, that is stiffness coefficient. So, in the first case, we applied only vertical displacement, we are not allowed rotation. So, that creates a moment, that is K21. Next one, for getting the second column, this is a rotation coordinate. So, this is a moment if it is a force, this is a rotation if it is a displacement. So, for getting the second column, we have to allow the displacement only, namely rotation. Rotation along coordinate 2, by that time, we should not allow any displacement. Therefore, so this will be acting as a simply supported beam. So, you will have only rotation. Only rotation means clockwise. Therefore, in this direction, you can assume your clockwise rotation. At no other point, you are allowed displacement. So, this is the rotation. So, this rotation is unity. That is, along the direction 2. That means you have to treat this as a simply support beam. You should not allow any vertical displacement. Now, you have to find out the force. The force that is developed here is the force along coordinate 2 due to unit displacement along coordinate 2. Now this force here, the force here may be upwards or may be downwards. It's not a problem. So this is the force along coordinate 1, due to unit displacement along coordinate 2, unit displacement. So the first suffix stands for where the force is measured. K1 is the force at 1. K2 is force along coordinate. So this is the force developed along. Yes. 4 cells developed along 1. So this is actually change this. So this is the force developed along coordinate 2 due to unit displacement only along coordinate 2. This is the force developed along coordinate 1. This is coordinate 1 direction. Force developed along coordinate 1 due to unit displacement along coordinate 2. So that will give you the second column of the matrix K12, K22. That will give you the second column of the matrix. So again, I repeat the definition for stiffness coefficient Kij. Kij stands for the force developed at coordinate I due to unit displacement along coordinate J with the condition that no displacement occurs except at J. When you allow displacement along 1, we are not allowed any rotation. When you allow rotation, we are not allowed any displacement. That is the meaning of the stiffness coefficient. So this is again an example for getting the stiffness coefficients. So the stiffness coefficients K12, K11, K12, etc. form the stiffness matrix. Once the stiffness matrix is formed, the displacements, the unknowns, the primary unknowns in the stiffness matrix method is equal to K inverse into F. Then how to find out for statically indeterminate structures? Again, we will discuss after the introduction to the method. So this is only to define what is the stiffness coefficient, what is the stiffness matrix, what are the unknowns and these things. So after this discussion, we will just discuss the step-by-step procedure for the matrix flexibility method, step-by-step procedure for the matrix stiffness method, and how to solve a given determined or indeterminate structure. All those things we will discuss later. Now this, we have used the equilibrium equation, and here we have applied superposition of displacements. That is, so for, there are two reasons for calling this as stiffness method. One is the displacements are the unknowns, therefore it is called a displacement method. And also we have used superposition of displacements. We applied one displacement at a time. In both cases we applied, first case we applied only vertical displacement. First case we applied only vertical displacement along coordinate 1, found out the forces. In the second one, we applied only the rotation. Actually, in the given structure, consists of two coordinates. One is this one and one is this one. So, here we applied the displacements and found out the forces. So, applied one displacement at a time. And we have combined them. For getting the combined effect, we have combined this and this. Therefore, it is called as a... we have applied superposition of displacements here. So these are the reasons for calling the method as a matrix stiffness method. That's about stiffness. So how to make use of these values for determinate indeterminate structures, how to solve them, how to get the bending moment diagram, all those things we'll discuss later. As I told, the knowledge on the static indeterminacy and the kinematic indeterminacy is very important, because for matrix flexibility method, static indeterminacy we know that we have got three equations of equilibrium, sigma v equal to 0, sigma h equal to 0, and the sigma m equal to 0. If a structure can be completely analyzed, analyzed means we will find out the shear force, we will find out the bending moment, we will find out the slope, and we will find out the deflection or rotation also, twist also. So the forces, shear force and bending moment, will be necessary for designing the structure, and determination of displacements will be required for checking whether the designed structure is adequate, whether the deflection value is within the allowable limit, whether the rotation is within the allowable limit or not. We will find out. So analyzed means we will find out the shear force, bending moment, slope or deflection. When these values can be obtained only using these conditions of equilibrium, the structure is called a statically determinate structure. If these conditions are not sufficient, then the structure is called a statically indeterminate structure, because for solving n unknowns, we want n equations. Suppose there are 5 reaction components, we have got only 3 equations, so 2 will be the redundant value. So we have got 2 excess reaction components for which we have to seek 2 more equations. So the degree of static indeterminacy is 2. We have got only 3 equations of equilibrium. So if your structure can be completely analyzed by using only these conditions, it is called a statically determinate structure. Otherwise, it is called a statically. If it is more, if the reaction components is more than the number of equilibrium equation, we call it a static. So this determination of static indeterminacy is very important in the case of matrix flexibility method, because it deals with forces. Forces are unknowns here. Coming to kinematic indeterminacy, this is important for matrix stiffness method. We know kinematic indeterminacy stands for the number of possible joint displacements, So the size of the flexibility matrix, suppose if the static indeterminacy is 4, then size of the flexibility matrix will be 4 by 4. If there are 3 possible joint displacement, then the kinematic indeterminacy, then the size of the stiffness matrix will be 3 by 3. So that control, therefore, a knowledge on the matrix, degree of static indeterminacy, degree of kinematic indeterminacy is important. A knowledge on finding out the deflection of beams by moment area method or conjugate method becomes essential. And also the degree of, only when you find out the degree of static indeterminacy, we have to convert the structure statically determinate structure, or called primary structure. So the knowledge of this is necessary. And also the matrix operations, namely matrix addition, matrix inversion, and all these basics are required for becoming familiar with the matrix methods. The knowledge on all these things are necessary. So coming to primary structure, suppose if you want to analyze the statically indeterminate beam, a 2-span continuous beam, let it be subjected to a vertical load here, let it be subjected to UDL here. If you want to analyze this structure by matrix flexibility method, you want to find out the static indeterminacy. You know, static indeterminacy is given by, say, when a beam is subjected to only vertical loads, there are different methods. When it is subjected to only vertical loads, the static indeterminacy is given by vertical reactions plus end moments minus 2. There are 3 vertical reactions here, also end moment. So 3 vertical reactions plus end moment. One is here, so fixed here will have end moment. Here it is a simply subordinate that will not have any vertical. So end moment is only 1 at the left end, minus 2. Minus 2 means there are 3 equations of equilibrium, but there is no horizontal force or inclined force. Therefore, even though there is one equation sigma h equals 0, sigma h equals 0 will be of no use in the absence of horizontal or inclined force, therefore minus 2. So 3 plus 1 minus 2 equal to 2. So 2 is the static indeterminacy. So this, for if you want to analyze this structure by matrix flexibility method, we have to make the structure as a primary structure. Primary structure, as I told earlier, it is a statically determinate structure. That is, what we can do is, we can make the structure as a cantilever, with the given load. This is a primary structure. Or we can introduce a hinge here. This is also a statically determinate structure. Or we can make the structure statically determinate like this. It is a cantilever. It is a simply support because we introduce a hinge here. It is a simply support beam. This is an overhanging beam. So like this, there are number of ways of making a structure statically determinate. So here RB is one redundant. Suppose we call this as A, B, C. RB is one redundant. RC is another redundant. The force vector will be consisting of RB and then RC as redundant. Because we have removed RB and RC for making the structure statically determinate. R, the same beam can be made as a simply support beam. So here we have removed one moment here. This is one redundant, namely MA, this is MD, moment is redundant. Here we have removed the support at B, therefore RB is another redundant. So the redundants will be MA and then RB. R, the structure can be made statically determinate by making it as overhanging beam. Overhanging beam means what we have removed here is we have removed the moment here. When it is a free end, it cannot take any moment. So MA is one redundant. MA is one. Another reaction is RA and MA will be the redundant. Treating RA and MA as redundant, remove the support at A, make it as a overhanging beam and start the analysis. So loading will be as given before. So these are all, and we got some more options. So first we have to convert the structure as a primary structure or statically determinate structure. Then how to deal with the structure, we will discuss about the procedure. Procedure for matrix stiffness, matrix flexibility. So these fundamentals are very much essential for So this is only introduction. Other step by step procedure and more number of examples we will discuss in the subsequent classes. So this is only introduction. Actually, this method is meant for analysis of complex structures, large scale structures. So this is not meant for small structures like a 2-span continuous beam or 3-span continuous beam. It is meant for the analysis of multi-story buildings, complex bridge structures and so on. But we must know, so we can just for developing the software, writing a program, or when already software is available, how it works. So to know that, you must know the basics, what are the different terms, how to give the input data and so on, and how to interpret the results and so on. A knowledge on matrix flexibility and matrix stiffness method is not only that, other methods like Fine-Delman method. Final method also, the basics of this will be used for widely. The stiffness matrix will be used in the finite element analysis. So this is only to know how to deal with the structures by matrix flexibility method or matrix stiffness method. What the software does for that knowledge only, just we deal with. We'll, of course, in a class we'll be able to do only simple examples. So we'll just discuss with simple examples. So this is not meant for small structures like this. As my senior author or my guide Dr. Vaidyanathan sir has stated in the book somewhere, using this method for simple structures is like using a helicopter for going to the next state. He has beautifully stated somewhere, using a helicopter for going to the next state. So this is not meant for using a helicopter for going to the next state. So this is, the application is different. Anyway, we will just try to learn the method. So in the subsequent classes, we'll discuss the methods one by one elaborately, and then we'll just give more number of examples. So thank you for your patience in listening to my lecture. Thank you.